I'm Stephanie Cooke, and you are listening to the True North Country Comics Podcast.
Welcome to the True North Country Comics Podcast, dedicated to promote Canadian comic book creators and supporters. It's June 18th, 2021. I'm John Swinimer. If you want to drop me a line, you can contact me at john@truenorthcountrycomics.com. On this episode, I chat with Stephanie Cooke about life and more. This podcast is available on Apple Podcasts and Google Podcasts. It's also available on the True North Country Comics channel on YouTube. I invite you to like and subscribe. Stephanie is an award-winning writer and editor based out of Toronto. She's a comic book fan, avid gamer, movie watcher, and lover of music. In 2019, Stephanie won the Jean Day Award for Outstanding Anthology, Wayward Sisters TO Comics, as contributing writer. Her writing work is featured in Mark Miller's Miller World Annual, The Secret Loves of Geek Girls, Toronto Comics Anthology, and more. Her current debut graphic novel, Oh My Gods, was just released from NMH Kids, to be followed by Paranorthern in the very near future. Her current Kickstarter project is Life from TO Comics Press. Part documentary, part drama, Life is a wordless, 44-page collection, collecting five short stories set on a mysterious alien world full of wonderfully strange creatures. Co-created by Stephanie and Megan Wong, Life began as backups for Image Comics' Tartarus. Collected in one place for the first and only time, this is a chance to get these stories in one unified collection. And as a special bonus, Life also includes Megan's original creature design in the bestiary alongside Steph's world-building notes. And so without further ado, here's my chat with Stephanie Cooke about Life and more.
So Stephanie Cooke, thank you very much for taking time to chat with me.
Thank you for having me. So excited to be back again.
Absolutely. It's great talking to you. So I wanted to catch up first, though, and ask, what are you reading today?
Oh, gosh. I actually, funnily enough, I had kind of a little bit of a delay in reading comics where I just was kind of swamped and I'd be like, oh, yeah, I want to read. And then I'd pass out, you know, like I'd go to bed and I just didn't really have much of a capacity, but I've been putting some time in my days to just read. And so last week I had two full days where all I did was read. So this is a loaded question because I've read a lot lately. Some highlights, Katie the Cat Sitter, which was Colleen A.F. Venable and Stephanie Yu. It's the unofficial middle grade Catwoman that I didn't know I wanted and needed in my life.
Oh, you have a cat too, right?
I do. Oh. I'm very allergic. I have her regardless, but yes. It was such a fun read. So it was very close to my heart. I love cats, and it was definitely filled with them and hit that quota for me for sure. But it was a delight. So that was one of the more recent things I read. I read Hench Girl by Kristen Gudsnick, which was fabulous. It's been out for a little while from Dark Horse. I kind of feel like it's the villain companion to The Adventures of Superhero Girl by fellow Canuck Faith Erin Hicks.
Right.
Except, you know, not, because they're by completely different people.
Right.
But yeah, I've just been going through a lot of things and trying to play catch up on books that I've been meaning to get to for sometimes weeks, sometimes months, sometimes years. So
yeah, it's tough. I know life gets in the way, but you get through it eventually. There you go. So we're here talking about your latest project, Life, Beauty, Wonder, and Danger. Wonder if you could talk a bit about that project, maybe some of the origins about it too.
Yeah, of course. So it's on Kickstarter right now. We've partnered up with Toronto Comics, who do the wonderful Toronto Comics anthology, Wayward Sisters, Wayward Kindred. They did the Shout Out anthology, and we've teamed up with them to print this book, which will be their first original graphic novel, which is very exciting. I love Toronto Comics. Andrew does wonderful work there. So Life is basically a series of silent short comics. And they were originally created as backup stories for a book I was editing at Image Comics Tartarus by Johnny Crispus and Jack T. Cole. So they were originally designed to be short stories to go in the back of the single issues. But yeah, Megan and I really just loved this project so much that we wanted to collect them and bring them together, since, again, they were only available in these single issues, and we wanted a place where they could exist on their own.
Ah, great. Yeah, no, it's sometimes a good thing when you know, it's tough to find these issues, these single issues sometimes, although it's on digital. But to have it all in one place, though, is quite unique. Was there a point in any type of the process, creation process, where you said, gosh, this would be a good thing as a standalone book? Did that come, like, did a bell go off or a light go off and say, aha?
Kind of, like... We definitely thought about it at the beginning. You know, I wanted them to stand alone, but I deliberately kind of tied them together in a loose way. So when you read the stories, you may notice that they end, but there's a new creature introduced usually in the last few panels, or maybe the last panel. And nothing really is happening with that character, just in case we didn't do more. But the next story usually started off with that character or creature that we last saw. So the thread continued. So the idea that we wanted to maybe collect them was there, but we didn't know how many we were really going to do and just what sort of demand there would be for it, if anyone would be into it or not. You know, Megan's art is incredible, but they're silent comics, and I wasn't sure if that would be kind of too niche or, you know, whatever. We loved the idea of trying to get like a one-shot, you know, companion book out with somebody. We had talked about doing Kickstarter just ourselves, and I was personally overwhelmed at the thought of doing it just on my own. I know how much work Kickstarters are. We spoke with Andrew at Toronto Comics, TO Comics, and, you know, after the books had finally stopped coming out through Tartarus, because Tartarus just is on hiatus right now, we decided that we would team up with Andrew and make this happen, because he has a plethora of knowledge when it comes to Kickstarters and could really aid us in making this come to life. So it was a dream partnership.
Sure, absolutely. Speaking of partnerships, you and Megan worked together on this, and I wonder if you could just describe a wee bit about how you, what was the collaboration process? How did you come together with both this wordless sort of story and the art?
Yeah, so, you know, like, I still scripted everything that we did, but obviously there's no dialogue, there's a couple sound effects, but for the most part, there's no words on the page. It's just the art that is standing alone. So I was kind of just doing art direction with the scripts, essentially. But I always wanted to work with Megan, and we've been talking about doing a project together for, I don't even know how long. Like, time is weird, and I can't remember where I am, who I am, how old I am, you know, etc. I knew Megan had posted somewhere along the lines these character designs, and, you know, she posts up a lot of concept art and costume redesigns and all these like amazing things too. But I had seen her post something that had kind of piqued my curiosity, in that maybe she might be interested in doing something that I hadn't seen her tackle before. And that was kind of this world building and animal creation and that sort of thing. And luckily for me, Megan really loves Pokemon. So when I was like, hi, let's have a hybrid caterpillar, like, but it turns into a bird, and oh, let's do a sloth frog, or like all this stuff, like, she was like, yes, like it, I think, you know, scratched that itch to have some sort of Pokemon-esque story out in the world. That makes it sound a little less serious than it is. Like, the stories are not quite as delightful and full of whimsy, I would say, as Pokemon. But yeah, Megan was just incredible. And basically, there were a couple stories right off the bat that I had concepts for and general ideas of what I wanted the creatures to be. But as we went along, Megan would be like, you know what? I really like frogs. I really like frogs. And like, we'd be like, well, do you think you could like integrate a frog into the story or like whatever? And we kind of just started spitballing the creatures, or again, like Megan would be like, I envision this. What about this? And she would do concepts for it. And, you know, I really gave minimal instruction, I guess, for the concept of the characters. Like, she had the scripts, she had the general idea of what was in my head, and I just let her kind of go wild. And we're friends, so, you know, like, she could talk to me and reach out if she had questions, and we spitballed some stuff. But yeah, it was such an amazing collaboration with her.
Great. Yeah, it shows, that's for sure. Now, this book is called Part Documentary, Part Drama, and I'm wondering if you could explain that a bit more. Were there any specific documentaries that inspired you?
Yeah, so I think, you know, the documentary feel comes very much from something like Planet Life, where, you know, David Attenborough is showing us nature at its finest and letting things take their course. So we basically get to sit in on a few moments of one of these creatures and watch as part of their life transpires before our eyes. So it's not always, again, whimsical, like Pokemon or something. There's moments when they're in peril or, you know, something's happening to them that creates that fight or flight response, which is very appropriate to the first story. Yeah, like, we wanted to kind of not just envision, like, this, you know, utopian wildlife world, but we wanted to make sure that we were kind of also encompassing what would happen with predators and prey there, and play around with that sort of different angle of things. So, yeah, it was, I think that's kind of, obviously it's not nonfiction, you know, it's fiction.
Sure.
But documentary-esque.
Right. Sure. Sure. Now, you mentioned the term world building before. So I wanted to ask, did you have to set your own sort of rules or impose your own guidelines as to how far you would go in the world building? Because that can go on forever. So you had to put a stake in the ground and say, no, no, we're not going to do anything more than this. Did that happen?
Kind of yes and kind of no, but only in the sense that with Johnny and Jack, when we were building the story for the backups, we didn't want to tie it into Tartarus directly. We didn't know if Jack and Johnny would visit, you know, the wilds of Tartarus or anything like that. So we didn't want to infringe on what Jack might envision for the world beyond the cities and stuff. So that was really the only limitations we had, was we didn't want to include humans. We didn't want to kind of, you know, broach on the world of Tartarus. Like, that was Johnny and Jack's world, and ours had to be, you know, like, it didn't have to be related at all. Johnny wonderfully gave us like carte blanche to just do whatever, but we wanted it to be far off and alien and kind of still play around with that sci-fi space, fantasy, alien world kind of stuff. So that was really the only thing that we wanted to kind of like make sure we had a boundary on. Other than that, it was kind of just, you know, I imagined that most habitable other worlds would be similar to ours, in that, you know, we'd want to explore probably like prairies, grasslands, like jungles, oceans, and what those would kind of look like and how similar they would be in certain ways, but then also very different. So there was no real limits, but we definitely wanted to have some parts of it grounded in a reality that we're currently aware of while mixing it with far off world fantasy.
Okay. Yeah. Absolutely. It makes sense. Makes sense. So working with TO Comic Express, their books are always successful, always well received. So with that in mind, are there plans for a follow-up to this book?
I'm not sure yet. So currently Tartarus is on hiatus. So originally we had started the books again, as backups to Tartarus, or the stories as backups. We pushed through kind of making more of them to be a part of this wonderful story that Johnny and Jack had built, and we haven't thought up any more at this time. But, I mean, there's so much that you could do with this world, and the first story is the longest, and then kind of the rest of them are a bit shorter, but there's definitely room to play around with some of the creatures we've seen, some new creatures that could definitely be brought to life. And who knows?
Okay. Something to look forward to. There you go. Now, I hear you're keeping busy to the point now that you've got yet another book coming along in July called Para Northern with Mary Costa. And I wonder if you could talk a bit about that book, what it's all about.
Yeah, I'm so excited. This month and next month are so busy. Actually, this whole year is really busy. But yeah, Para Northern and the Chaos Bunny, a Hopcalypse. It's about a young witch named Abby and her friends, Silas, who's a pumpkinhead, Gita, who's a wolf girl, and Hannah, who's a ghost. But ghosts aren't actually dead in this world. They're just beings from other dimensions. And basically, Abby accidentally opens up a portal to another dimension. And this dimension is filled with chaos bunnies. And I liken the chaos bunnies to be a bit like Stitch from Lilo and Stitch. Mm-hmm. They're not inherently evil, but they're very, very mischievous, and you definitely don't want them in your world. They can see in this portal, and the world where these chaos bunnies have come from is ravished. It's just, you know, been eaten and destroyed, decimated. So now that this portal's open, the bunnies are all coming in and starting to cause chaos everywhere. Abby and her friends have to figure out how to close this portal and get all of the bunnies back from whence they came before they destroy their town of North Haven, and maybe even beyond that. So they have to team up and figure out how.
That's an adventure for sure. So I wonder if you could talk a bit about how this collaboration worked in conjunction with Megan. So with Mary, it's a new creator, I guess, you're working with. You haven't worked with her before.
Yeah. So it's funny because, like, Para Northern was actually the very first thing that I sold with HMH Kids, HMH Books. And, you know, I'd worked with Juliana on Oh My Gods and Incha, but we'd brought Juliana on board. So when we sold Oh My Gods, we were a package deal. So we'd already had the artist established, which is pretty much the norm in the comics industry. But in the book industry, sometimes you can pitch as a solo writer and a publisher will help you find an artist, right? So that was the case with Para Northern. So I didn't have an artist on board for the book. And basically, my wonderful editor, Lily, was like, who are the people you'd want to work with? And, you know, we tried to get a few of the people that were like on the top list, which was great. But then we basically were trying to develop a list of who would fit that style or like what kind of look we wanted for the book. And Lily found Mari. Mm. So basically, HMH reached out and was the point person on all of that. I didn't really collaborate with her a whole lot, to be honest. You know, we talked initially about the early designs for the characters, and I didn't have any specific things in mind for anyone. Like, I would have been happy if she's like, I think this person should be this or this or this mm-hmm. or this, and like, mm-hmm. it'd be great. And in fact, Hannah, I had just kind of written her with no ethnicity in mind, but because of her backstory in the book, Mari wanted to know if we would be okay with her being Muslim, because she felt that would really resonate with audiences. So I was more than happy to let Mari take the lead on that based on the story. And then other than that, she just worked kind of hand in hand with my editor and our art director to do the pages and the art. So I didn't really have a big say in that, which is, you know, very different from other experiences I've had too. It's a bit all over the place with the book market, but it's been great. I love the final art. I trusted my editors and the book designers. Like, they 100% were behind, you know, they could see into my brain. I could feel it, and they knew what was there, and they were able to pull that out and oversee Mari with you know, no hesitation from me whatsoever. I was happy to kind of let them take the lead there.
Well, I'm great it all worked out and that everyone's happy with the results. That's tremendous.
Yeah, good stuff. It's a bit bizarre sometimes because, like, again, like the comic industry, I feel like a lot of the time, although not always, it's pretty like collaborative where, you know, artists, writers, all that stuff, like you're working pretty closely. Again, that's not always the case. Sometimes you don't see the final thing until the book's on the shelves.
Oh, my.
Which I've had happen. But yeah, this, you know, I saw steps along the way, but I was largely happy again to just let my team take the lead.
Well, that's great. Good. I'm glad it worked out. Also, congrats on the success of Oh My Gods. I mean, that's tremendous. As your debut graphic novel, that's wonderful. Mm. And I just wanted to see, you know, with all the success that you're getting, what's next? Is there a follow-up coming along too?
Yeah, for Oh My Gods, we have a sequel coming out. We actually, you are getting kind of, I guess, a little exclusive look. We haven't announced it like publicly yet, but we were originally planning on releasing Oh My Gods 2 in January. We've pushed that back to April to let our artist have a little bit more time because the deadlines were so back-to-back and we're giving it a little bit more breathing room. So it'll be out in April, at the beginning of April of 2022. So a couple months after the January release date, which was originally supposed to be happening.
Right. Well, as I say, good things come to those who wait. So I'm sure it'll be wonderful when it comes out.
I hope so. I'm really excited. We had a lot of fun with this book. And, you know, like, I'm just so grateful that people, especially kids, like it's really resonating with them. You know, Greek mythology is something that was close to my heart when I was growing up. And something like this would have been right up my alley. And obviously it is because I co-wrote it. But like, you know, like I just would have loved something like this when I was a kid. And I actually got like, we got like in the span of a week, like one fan letter was sent to me and then one was kind of posted online. But like, my heart, like, what? It was just the nicest. I had a little 8-year-old girl write me, and it just made my whole world. It was wonderful. So
that's tremendous. Yeah. That's good stuff. So you got so much on the go. I'm wondering where you recommend people go to follow you online and through social media to find out more about what's up with Stephanie Cooke.
Yeah, so you can go to stephaniecooke.ca, got that good old Canadian domain. That's pretty much the home of everything to do with me. You can find all my social media and stuff there too. But Twitter and Instagram, I'm on quite often, and that is at Hello Cookie. And then I also just launched a new podcast with Whitney Gardner, who's another fabulous middle grade comic creator, called The Capercast. So that's available now, and you can go to capercast.com to check that out.
Thanks to Stephanie for the chat. You can discover more about Stephanie on Twitter and Instagram at HelloCookie and online at stephaniecooke.ca. You can hear Stephanie and Whitney Gardner on the CaperCast podcast at capercast.com. And thanks to you for listening to the True North Country Comics podcast. If you haven't done so already, please subscribe to and like this podcast on Apple Podcasts. And please leave a good rating. Also check out the TrueNorthCountryComics.com website and follow on Twitter at True North Comics. True North Country Comics is now on YouTube. Please like and subscribe to that video channel. Please send your feedback to John at TrueNorthCountryComics.com. Thanks again for listening, and come back soon for another episode. Bye for now. True North Country Comics Podcast is copyright True North Country Comics, copyright 2021.